get a blood pressure?
Okay, we've got an unrecordable blood pressure.
Ethan's horse is fallen. He's gone over the front of it. It's then rolled on top of him.
Fast scan.
Grossly positive. Fast.
He's bleeding internally. And without intervention, he's likely to die.
Red cells in.
Yeah.
Right, squeeze.
We're measuring time we've got to save his life in minutes.
So I don't have palpable pulses.
Is he responding?
Ethan, can you open your eyes?
Would you rescue me when I'm by myself? When I need your love, if I need your help, would you rescue me? Would you rescue me? But I...
Very worried for you, my friend.
The bone's being smashed to bits.
Whoa!
He's actually stopped breathing.
Leah.
Without intervention, he's quite likely to die.
Dada?
The Royal Melbourne, one of the busiest trauma hospitals in Australia, emergency medicine doesn't stop. With more than 250 patients arriving every day. Frontline senior emergency doctor Jonathan Papson is back ready for his first shift after holidays. But so far, it's not going too well.
Oh, I'm locked out. So I've just come back to work.
Yeah.
And if you put the wrong password in a few times, you get locked out. Guess what? I'm locked out.
Leaving behind the frustrations of technology, Dr. Jonathan heads down to a super busy ED.
Royal Melbourne tab speaking.
There's a serious trauma coming in.
She's T-boned the truck. Yeah.
Air ambulance is on the way with a badly injured pregnant woman from country Victoria.
9:45.
Yeah. Chopper.
On hand is emergency doctor Scott Taylor.
I'll take it.
Yep. We're expecting a lady who's been involved in a very high-speed car accident. We have to expect the worst, that this patient is unstable, may have some life or limb-threatening injuries.
With two lives that may need saving, Dr. Scott calls on the experience of Dr. Jonathan.
I need an extra set of hands. Would you like to help? No worries. All right, thanks, bye.
Oh my God. Okay, 24-year-old, 9:45. And early pregnancy as well.
Looks like we've got a bad car crash and a pregnant woman. And those two things are a bad combination.
On the rooftop, air ambulance touches down with the 24-year-old who was driving to work when her car collided with a truck at high speed. She's suffering multiple injuries and in excruciating pain.
That extra pain relief kicked in?
Not really. Feel more sick than anything.
Okay.
With such a badly injured patient, it's all hands on deck, with Dr. Scott taking the lead.
Caitlin, I'm Scott. One of the emergency specialists. We've got Jonathan, another one of the emergency specialists as well. He's going to do a quick ultrasound.
Okay.
There's going to be lots of voices, lots of loud voices, and lots of people and lots of things happening.
Okay.
Just stop us at any point if you have any questions or things are a bit overwhelming, okay? All right. You're 9 weeks pregnant, is that right? Have you had an ultrasound?
Yeah, I had one yesterday.
Okay, and everything?
Everything was fine.
Okay.
Caitlin, I'm Ebony. You okay?
Yeah.
Good stuff.
She's pregnant, which struck a bit of a chord with me being pregnant myself. You don't just think about one patient, there's also another patient involved, and that's the baby. So it's a very serious situation.
One, two, three. Oh.
Emergency nurse Ebony Lee Butterworth is protecting Caitlin's neck in case she has spinal injuries.
Across on three. One, two, three. Oh, oh. Good job. There we are.
About 7:30 this morning, she's driving a late model SUV-type vehicle on a 110-kilometre-an-hour freeway. A truck has pulled out into her and she's ploughed into the truck without having the chance to do much braking.
Yes, sir.
She's T-boned a truck.
T-boned a truck.
Significant damage to the front of her car, essentially been destroyed.
Terrified, Caitlin managed to drag herself from her mangled car before emergency services arrived.
She's got general soreness across her tummy and some nasty abrasions from the seatbelt. Obvious swelling and deformity to her right femur with some shortening and rotation of her right leg. She's got a nasty lack to her left knee and an obvious closed fracture to her right wrist.
She doesn't look good and she's in pain. So what's happened inside? That's the thing. She might be bleeding internally, and that's what I'm worried about.
Dr. Jonathan quickly scans for any internal injuries that may be a risk to Caitlin's life and the life of her unborn baby.
Are you sore on this side of the chest?
Yeah.
Yeah. Sorry if it hurts. I'm just checking.
That's okay.
Just checking to make sure you haven't got a punctured lung. So there's blood everywhere. It's not much.
Yep.
But there is. And she's got the huge seatbelt sign.
Yep.
And there's the fetal business.
I can see blood inside her abdomen where it shouldn't be. And that means trouble. I mean, she's going to have some injuries in her abdomen, and that may have some implications on Caitlin's baby as well.
That hurts.
Sorry, that's sore.
Yeah.
Sorry about that.
Can you see any more detail?
Both Dr. Jonathan and Dr. Scott keep scanning, anxious to see any signs that the baby is still alive.
I don't know. Can you see anything going on there?
After 6 months working in the Royal Melbourne Hospital's intensive care unit, emergency registrar Dr. Andrew Wallace is happy to be back in the ED.
I feel most at home in the emergency department. I love the organised chaos of it. I love everyone pulling together for the same goal to try and help really sick patients.
Within minutes of hitting the ED floor, Dr. Andrew's first case comes in.
Royal Melbourne receiving, go ahead.
There's been a horrific accident at a race course just a few kilometres from the Royal Melbourne.
Royal Melbourne receiving, can you just repeat the blood pressure, please?
Blood pressure 54 on 30.
There's a major trauma coming in. Jockey has fallen off his horse and then potentially been crushed. His injuries could be absolutely critical, completely life-changing. So we need to prepare a major response.
OK, what do you want to do, Andrew?
Get the med pack prepared, consideration that it might be oxstat.
Yeah.
Dr. Andrew takes the lead, assisted by his mentor, senior emergency doctor Jana Alexander.
X-ray and pelvic X-ray here and ready and waiting.
Paramedics are rushing in professional jockey Ethan, who has life-threatening injuries after falling off his horse in the middle of a race.
Stay sitting a little bit. Are you OK? I'm going to just keep annoying you up here, OK?
Ethan's horse has shifted. It's fallen. He's gone over the front of it. It's then rolled on top of him.
Yep.
They're complaining of right femur pain, abdo pain and pelvic pain.
Most recent blood pressure?
55 on 40.
65 on 40. Ethan's blood pressure is incredibly low. I'm really worried that he's got major organ damage. He's bleeding internally. And without intervention, he's quite likely to die.
Hi there. My name's Jana. I'm one of the emergency doctors, OK? I'm going to take good care of you. We're just going to get you over onto our bed now. All right? OK.
On the count of three, we're rolling all the way across.
Ethan's girlfriend, Celine, was at the race course when the horse tripped and rolled.
I just ran out onto the track where he was. It was about 200-metre run, and he was just pale, yellow. His face was in shock. He just looked like he was going to die.
Fast scan.
Dr. Jana urgently scans, looking for internal bleeding that could be threatening Ethan's life.
So, gross B positive, fast. Left upper, right upper quadrant.
Yep.
Pelvis.
Yep.
What I can see is free fluid in the abdomen. That means blood, which is extremely serious. It suggests that he's got solid organ injuries. It's extremely life-threatening and he needs an immediate blood transfusion if he's going to survive.
The priority is chasing the med pack, get blood into him.
So I don't have palpable pulses when I just check.
What is he responding?
Ethan, can you open your eyes? Yeah.
Yeah, responding. Med pack, get in. Can we get red cells in?
Yeah.
Can we have a dedicated nurse in the med pack?
Can we get a nurse?
Yep. That's priority.
Ethan's blood pressure is plummeting. He's fading fast.
Andrew, we need to be pushing for an opstat.
Yep, absolutely. OK, so disposition's opstat. Calling ops, that is the highest level that we can do. It means that we need to get him to theatre immediately. We're measuring time we've got to save his life in minutes.
Can I get a blood pressure?
They're not getting one.
Okay, we've got an unrecordable blood pressure.
Med pack, get in. Can we get red cells in?
Dr. Andrew and Dr. Jana have declared a priority emergency.
Dispositions op stat.
Desperately trying to save the life of young jockey Ethan, who's been trampled by a horse.
Priorities just now is getting the med pack in as soon as we can. We'll do it bilaterally.
Do we have a blood checking clinician side as well?
For this side as well.
I can do one side.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. Great. Thank you.
Sorry, did I get
you? No, you're fine.
Trying to get Ethan's blood pressure up, they pump blood into both arms.
Right, squeeze.
We're having to literally squeeze blood into him to get it in as quickly as possible.
Dr. Jana prepares for the worst.
Lauren, if we go into traumatic cardiac arrest, you're ready to go with decompression, and you can do both sides.
Ben, do you think you can squeeze because you've got lead on so we can get some x-rays?
Yep, that's right.
It's vital to get x-rays to see if Ethan has other serious injuries the surgeons need to know about.
Everyone who's not in lead, get out. Right. That's right, their pelvis.
Dr. Jana and Dr. Andrew quickly look for life-threatening injuries.
Okay, so it's going to be spleen or liver.
Looking at the x-rays, it's reassuring that he hasn't got an injury to the pelvis.
You're doing really well, okay? You've got some blood in your tummy, okay? So we think you probably have an injury to your spleen, maybe your liver, okay? But your blood pressure is very low, so they're going to take you upstairs.
You have to try and imagine how terrifying it must be to be extremely fit at the peak of your career, and then all of a sudden you're flat on your back and you can't move your neck, and they're scared. Just holding their hand or mentioning a few nice, reassuring things can, you know, have a huge, profound effect.
But you're safe. We're going to take really good care of you, OK?
How far away theatre are we?
I'm thinking we've got a theatre. We've got...
Right, OK. FFP next bag, left side. So we've done three red cells. Lynn, next pack, FFP.
Even though Ethan has been given more than six bags of blood, he's deteriorating rapidly.
We're just buying him time. If we don't stop the blood flowing out, all his organs are going to suffer, his heart, his brain, everything. He's going to die within minutes.
So once we've got ketamine and once we've got the yellow drug bag, we should be good to go.
We've got a drug bag. We're ready to go.
Right, OK.
You are coming up. Andrew, I'll go up with them.
OK.
Dr. Jana stays with Ethan to make sure he survives the trip to theatre, where surgeons will try to stop the internal bleeding.
We've done everything we can for Ethan in our emergency department. We're now leaving it to the trauma surgeons to save his life.
So there's blood everywhere. Right upper quadrant, left upper quadrant.
24-year-old pregnant Caitlin has multiple injuries from a high-speed car crash, but it's internal bleeding that has Dr. Scott and Dr. Jonathan worried.
Can you see any more detail?
They're trying to see signs that Caitlin's baby is alive.
I don't know. Can you see anything going on there?
I'm trying to find the fetal heartbeat. The pressure's really on. I've got a bad feeling about this.
That's it.
It's a tiny little pop, 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 pop. It's like a moving target.
Seeing that heartbeat was such a relief for us and also for Caitlin.
We can see your little baby in there.
Yeah.
Yeah, but that's all I can say. You know, you've had a nasty blow there. You've got a little bit of fluid in your tummy, which means you've got some bruising and stuff going on in there. Yeah. And we're going to see where that's coming from.
Yeah. All right.
Tiny little baby in there, in a nice big bag of fluid and inside her uterus or womb. We'd need to worry more about her other organs than the baby.
Do you have any other kids?
No.
This is your first bub?
Yep.
It's very exciting.
Yeah.
As Caitlin's car crashed into the truck, her first thoughts were of her fiancé, Riley, who is now on his way.
When she had the incident, she actually rang me. I answered, and she's screaming my name, help. Got there, and it was real daunting seeing the car and immediately thought the worst. She wasn't going to be there. She wasn't going to be with us.
OK, so, team, we're ready for some x-rays. Ems, do you need a little bit longer there?
I've got, I'll just pause and come back.
Caitlin urgently needs x-rays and a scan to see what other injuries she has and to find the source of her internal bleeding.
So she's early pregnancy, but we have to scan her anyway.
Yep.
That's the bottom line.
Yeah.
Not ideal, but it's what we have to do.
We treat mum like she's not pregnant. We're looking for a number of life-threatening injuries. Those injuries will hurt the baby way more than any x-ray we give the baby.
X-ray.
As the day progresses, the number of trauma calls is increasing.
Jason.
Senior emergency doctor Jason Gabriel Anusor has been part of the ED team for 7 years and thrives on the unexpected.
It's already shaping up to be a very busy day that can make things more interesting and exciting, and every patient is different.
Dr. Jason's next patient, Manon, has arrived into a trauma bay.
Do you want to do head, Jenna?
Yes, I'll do head.
The 27-year-old bartender was badly injured when her motorbike crashed into a truck. She's been given the green whistle for pain relief, but is still in agony.
Ready? One, two,
we'll go
three.
Very slowly. Sorry. There we go. Okay.
Emergency nurse Gigi Ferrer is known for his ability to put patients at ease.
There we go.
Oh, that was good.
That was nice and smooth. How are you going there, Manon?
I think nursing is so special. I get this opportunity to be some sort of comfort or some sort of human connection for these people who are really suffering and going through quite a lot.
Manon?
Yeah?
Do you have any allergies to medication?
Penicillin.
Okay, all right.
Hello, Manon.
Hello.
My name's Jason. I'm one of the doctors.
Okay.
Do you remember what happened?
Yes, I was on my motorbike.
Mm-hmm.
And I hurt a truck.
Did you lose consciousness?
Yes.
You did?
Yes, during like 2 minutes.
Okay.
Yeah.
She was driving a moped. Approximately 54 minutes an hour.
Really?
She's then, seems like, lost control over a bit of water on the road.
Yeah.
And then glide into the rear end of a parked truck. So you've got to imagine the truck, the steel bit comes across like here. The mopeds actually ended up like kind of jammed in under it.
Both deformed?
But yeah, significant. Yeah.
With the speed that Manon's come off her motorbike and loss of consciousness, I need to exclude an intracranial injury. So we need to get some scans, but before that, we really need to get her pain better managed.
We'll go with some fentanyl and IV paracetamol.
Thank you.
It's got to be doing some x-rays quickly, so I need you to be very still, yeah?
OK.
As the pain medication takes effect, they can start to examine Manon's badly damaged wrists.
I can just turn your hand just a little bit.
Manon arrived alone in Australia 3 weeks ago on a 12-month working visa, leaving family and friends back in France.
My contact person, it is my husband.
And what's his name?
It is Joris.
The trauma team makes sure her husband in Paris knows what's happening.
0202.
With Manon being so young and being so far from home, I think it struck a chord with me.
So are you here on holiday?
No, for working.
Ah, what did you do for
working
work?
Holiday visa.
Yes.
And I'm bartender.
Oh, nice.
Mm.
She's alone, you know, and she's meant to be having the time of life, and she's here instead in an emergency.
What's your favourite cocktail to make?
Oh, I have a lot, but I like Negroni.
I love Negroni. Stagliato.
You like it? Oh, you like it? You do, you know,
of
this
course,
cocktail.
Of course I do. Okay. It's not my first rodeo.
Manon's x-rays have come through, and the results are alarming.
This is her right wrist, so she's broken across the bigger bone in her wrist. It's moved off, and then on the left, that wrist is broken, and you could see that it was a bit more deformed compared to the other one, because you can see where that fracture is. It seems to be completely off the end of the bone. To improve her pain, we need to try and get the bones as realigned as possible. It requires a lot of force to reduce these type of fractures, and it can look quite confronting to people who aren't aware of exactly what we're trying to achieve.
In the emergency department, French traveller Manon has badly broken wrists after she crashed her moped into the back of a truck.
You're okay. You're in a safe space, okay?
Okay.
Manon is in agony, needing a high level of sedation before they can straighten and plaster her broken wrists.
It's 25 of ketamine.
Going to feel very good shortly, I promise, Manon.
Okay.
It's a fine line. I try to get the dose right. I don't want someone awake and aware, but I don't want to give them so much medication that they stop breathing.
How you doing, Manon? Manon?
Yes?
How are you feeling?
Good.
You guys happy?
Yeah, we're ready.
Are you going to do left then right?
We'll do left, then we'll do right after
that. It's almost a bit like playing tug of war on her arm and her wrist to try and pull those bones back out to the proper position.
I can see that she is suffering at the moment. It is difficult to watch, but by doing this pretty intense procedure, we want to put the bones back into place so that pain is then minimised after this, and so it gives it a chance for the healing process to start.
You're doing well, Manon.
Manon's pain is extreme.
And that's just another 25 of ketamine.
Dr. Jason slowly increases the medication, making sure she doesn't stop breathing.
You just got to go to space, Manon.
Okay.
I'm not too convinced that's how working. Well, yeah. That drip is working.
Yeah.
It's a problem with broken arms that the drips are round about where we're trying to put plasters and pull on her arm. Trying to get a second drip into her.
You're okay.
You're okay?
Yeah, you're good.
Okay.
You're very good. It's okay.
So she's a bit dissociated, but not enough.
Dr. Jason is trying to give just enough sedation so they can stabilise Manon's wrists without causing pain.
30 of ketamine, Jane.
Another 30?
Yeah.
It's okay, Manon. The medicine will work soon, I promise.
Okay.
Yeah. It's coming in now, okay?
Okay.
You're doing very well.
And another 30.
That's 130 all up?
Yes.
Ketamine is a drug where people are actually still awake, but they're often not aware of what's happening. We are giving Manon a decent dose, but that's still not quite cutting it for her.
X-ray.
24-year-old pregnant Caitlin has multiple injuries after a horrifying car crash. The team managed to see the baby's heart beating, but X-rays have everyone concerned.
It's blood everywhere. It's actually more around the spleen than around the liver. There's no pneumothorax on the right. It's just whether there's a little bit of fluid on the right lung.
Okay. She's got some internal bleeding, and it turns out she's got an injury to her spleen. The spleen has been shaken around, it's bled a little bit around.
As more X-rays are taken, Nurse Ebony lightens the moment.
Excuse me.
Yeah, okay. Huh? Is he all right there?
Hiccups.
Okay.
Just take a big breath. Big breath and hold it.
Me?
Yes.
Oh, I just have these spontaneous hiccups all the time.
Big breath and hold it.
Stand on your head.
Drink
all
water.
These funny things.
Drink water upside down.
We see so much awfulness all the time that any moment you can make light of the situation, we'll take the opportunity to do so. It relieves some of the pent-up stress that builds up in our job.
Excuse me.
X-ray results give Dr. Jonathan the information he needs.
You've definitely got a broken leg from what we think.
Yeah.
That'll need an operation.
Yep.
And you may yet need an operation on your tummy, depending on what we see there. Yeah. Because you do have some blood in there. We'll see what that looks like with the scanner.
We've got a pregnant trauma in trauma 2 at the moment. We're hoping to get round for a CT pan scan ASAP. We've made a decision that given Caitlin's currently stable, to put her through a CT scanner to figure out what exactly her internal injuries are. I'll be there shortly.
Was your forearm, it all bent and out of place?
My wrist was bent. It was bent inwards.
Yeah, you've probably broken both the bones in your arm, I think.
Yeah, it definitely hurts along like all of my palms.
I am sure. We can fix that though.
I keep looking at Caitlin and thinking, gosh, this girl is like so incredible. She's so brave and so stoic, coping with such a horrendous and scary situation.
It's a bit of a shitty day.
Yeah.
You're dealing with it very well, though.
Thanks.
Caitlin's fiancé, Riley, is still travelling to be with her. It's a lot for Caitlin to deal with on her own.
Did Jonathan talk to you any more about the ultrasound and your baby?
No.
OK, we think he can see a heartbeat there. Yeah. We'll have a proper look a little bit later on.
Yeah.
There's not much we can do at the moment.
Yeah.
The best thing we can do is look after you properly.
Yeah, 100%.
All right, and then that will give baby the best chance of being OK.
Yeah.
All right, ready, are we?
Yes, we're ready.
So we still don't know what's happening at this stage, and it's really important that we get to CT ASAP so that we can ensure that there's nothing sinister happening inside.
All right, just be mindful, we've got a femur fracture on the right. We're going to roll on three. One, two, three.
24-year-old car crash victim Caitlin is about to be scanned for multiple injuries after her car smashed into a truck.
Is that petrol?
Yeah.
Oh. The pregnant woman managed to pull herself from the smoking wreckage before help arrived.
She is covered in petrol. I notice that she's wet, and I get this overwhelming smell of fumes.
Two, three.
Oh my God, this situation is not only so bad that she's had this car accident, but this car could have burst into flames. That's left me in absolute shock.
Dr. Scott is hoping the scans will rule out any serious internal injuries.
And we'll have a chat about your scans when we get back. We'll just have a closer look. All right, thanks everybody.
It's an anxious time for Caitlin, waiting to know what other injuries she might have.
You all right? You feeling sick?
Mm. Good.
Her chest looks okay. She's got contained hematoma in her spleen. We're looking for any major injuries that may not be picked up on that first ultrasound scan. Oh, yeah. Following that, we're looking at an X-ray of her right thigh, which shows that she's got a pretty extensive multi-part fracture of her femur.
Dr. Scott now has the full picture of Caitlin's injuries.
Had a few things kind of happening around you. Mm-hmm. There's a bit of bruising around your spleen.
Yeah.
We can't see anything that's actively bleeding at the moment.
Yeah.
Your wrist is broken in a couple of places.
Yeah.
And we'll need to straighten that out. Your thigh bone broken in a few pieces.
Yeah.
That'll need a rod put through it. That wound on your left knee seems to go into the joint.
Yeah.
So that'll need a skin graft or a special kind of dressing over the top.
As the full extent of her injuries sink in, Caitlin's mum Sally and fiancé Riley finally arrive.
Elvis? Fine.
Fine.
Elvis is fine. Still a heartbeat.
Cool.
Yeah.
How are you feeling?
Black. I got hit by a truck.
That's okay.
But yeah, as soon as I hit it.
You hit the fuel tank of the truck.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, she was covered in
diesel.
Diesel,
was she?
But then the car caught fire. So I got myself out.
Half in half.
Yeah, so I undid my seatbelt and I opened the car and I fell out the car.
Ugh.
And I didn't get moved till the paramedics came.
Far out.
It could have been so much worse.
Oh, yeah. Like, I feel very lucky that I've only done damage on, not, you know, not minor parts, but definitely could have been so much worse. Like, it could have just killed me.
Caitlin's got a pretty big journey ahead of her. She's got lots of broken bones that are going to need extensive surgeries. We also don't know how this pregnancy is going to work out. It's going to be a journey of weeks and months, I fear.
So this is green.
Oh, well, we're all super abundant, aren't we?
Yeah.
Senior emergency doctor Martin Dutch is starting his shift trying to find out who's on his trauma team this afternoon.
What team are you on today?
Green.
Green, excellent. Well, I'll have nothing to do with you.
Yeah,
I'm on purple.
Okay.
I'm looking for purple people.
We have a number of doctors working at any one time, and we form teams. In this case, the purple team and the green team. That team report up to me.
Hi, Gina, Martin, come with me.
Royal Melbourne receiving.
The pace at the ED is not letting up.
Drew, coming to deliver the 21-year-old male, Tasman McCullough. The patient has been hit approximately 50 kilometres per hour. He's gone over the bonnet and then landed on the road.
Paramedics arrive with the young Japanese student who's in a lot of pain after being hit by a car as he crossed a city street.
Something about being painful.
Worried that Takaki has a head injury, Dr. Martin's first priority is to see how alert he is.
Hello. How are you feeling?
I'm a little scared.
You're scared. It's okay. There's a lot of people around.
Takaki told me that he was scared. That's a very human reaction. He's a long way from home, and having a serious event where he's hit by a car and taken into a large hospital, I can only imagine would be very, very frightening for him.
He's been hit on his left side, rolling over onto the bonnet, approximately 60 k's an hour. He's gone from the bonnet to the floor and has hit his face front first. He's got some pain to his left shoulder with his bruising and swelling.
One of the things I worry about when somebody has been hit at 60 kilometres an hour is life-threatening injuries, potentially, to the head, to the chest, to the abdomen. These are the sort of devastating life events that can change someone's life forever.
Takaki arrived at emergency with his friend Koshim, who was with him when he was hit.
We might just get this guy to sit up in the left-hand side of the room and he can interpret for us. I'm a little bit worried about your shoulder. I think you may have broken a bone in there, maybe. We'll take an X-ray and have a look.
Is it a scan?
Yeah, scan.
Is it not the pain?
The scan is not painful, no.
It is not electric.
What is not electric?
Open your
eyes and look up at the roof.
Electronic shock?
No, we don't do electric shocks here. OK, he's in hospital. We'll take care of him.
What language do you speak?
Japanese.
You might need to do a little phone interpreter because I think even our interpreter is struggling.
Emergency nurse Sarah Thomas turns to technology to get around the language barrier.
I need to tell Takaki what's going on right now because he's afraid.
Can you see?
Yes, okay.
So any online communication tools I'll use just to reassure him that we're going to figure out what's wrong with him and we're going to help him.
Sorry. Big breath in.
So the good news for Takaki is that both of his lungs are working normally and there's no life-threatening bleeding inside his abdomen.
Lots of pain up here? Yeah, it looks sore.
He's still being hit by a car at 60 kilometres an hour. We need to screen to see if there are any underlying injuries that we need to attend to.
So I'm going to get an X-ray of your chest and an X-ray of your hips.
You have already
counted? Not yet.
See, I don't think the brain is working that well.
No.
I'm increasingly concerned about what's going on with Takaki. He's at the least concussed, but there may be something even more serious going on inside his head.
All right, Manon, we're almost there, OK? We're almost there.
In the emergency department, French traveller Manon has two badly broken wrists.
My goodness!
The team are pulling them back into place before plastering.
Okay. Seems dissociated and sleepy, but they're not tolerating the reduction too well.
Dr. Jason is trying to get her pain under control.
I've given her a big dose of this first drug. Doesn't seem to be doing as much for her as I'd like, so going to add in a second powerful drug as well to help sedate her more, to tolerate the procedure. I think we'll go with some propofol.
Oh, my God.
With even stronger medication, finally, they are able to straighten and plaster Manon's arm.
Are you going there, Manon?
Yeah.
You good?
I'm good.
You are good, yes.
I'm super...
Yeah? You're super high.
I'm super high.
That's okay. That's where we want you to be.
Okay.
Just gonna do your right arm now, okay? You just relax. You're okay.
Okay.
You're okay, Mum.
What's wrong?
While she seems distressed, the combination of the medications means that when she wakes up, she won't remember any of this.
How?
Everything's okay.
With Manon fully sedated, they can now set her other arm in place.
Everything's good, Manon. Yeah. There we go.
All done. Very well done.
Thank you, team.
You okay, Manon? You did very well.
Do you have much pain at the moment, or...? No? Okay.
Okay.
Good, good. Are you enjoying the high?
Yes.
Yes, good.
This is a significant injury, and Manon is going to need some surgery to repair both of her wrists so she can have proper function of her hands going forward. She's a young lady still with a long working life ahead of her.
If I'm right, this is snapped in two. It's going to be sore.
In Resus Bay 4, Dr. Martin and Nurse Sarah are having trouble communicating with 21-year-old Takaki from Japan, who is terrified and struggling to understand what's happening.
We need to do more. More scans.
More scans?
Yeah, later.
Okay.
Right now, we're going to roll you, OK? Is everybody ready?
Yep.
One, two, three.
Slowly,
little
slowly,
bit.
Slowly.
Yes, yes, slowly, slowly, slowly. Yes, OK. You OK? Good.
For Takaki, I'm very aware that he's got an injured arm, but I need to still be able to consider that there may be other injuries going on.
Pain? No. Pain?
The team check for spinal injuries.
Pain? No.
It's immensely reassuring if the spine is not tender and sensation is normal.
You just probably got a broken bone.
Broken bone?
Probably.
Maybe.
Oh, no. My God.
Yeah. That's okay. We can fix that. We'll get the X-ray team in.
He's frightened and he doesn't speak any English.
X-ray. Nice and still there.
Takaki's humerus, or upper arm bone, has been snapped clean in two.
You can follow it up here, and then basically it stops just here where it's been fractured off, and it should be connected to this larger, round, ball-shaped piece of bone up here.
The X-ray confirms Takaki's arm is badly broken. But Dr. Martin has other concerns.
This guy has been hit at sort of 60 kilometres an hour by a car. There are reasons why, you know, because of his language, we'll miss stuff.
Okay.
So nothing is missed, Takaki's taken for a CT scan to look for any other injuries.
You get hot, okay, that's it. Just going to go in and out, in and out. OK.
Too hot?
Not too hot.
Not too hot, just a little hot, OK?
He's petrified. I think he's probably got a closed head injury as well, which is why things aren't computing exactly normally.
Yeah, yeah.
So this is a combination of things that are working against us.
I can see that Takaki's had a closed head injury. We're concerned that something might be going on with his brain. It may be injured, there may be bleeding inside his skull, compressing his brain.
It's a tense wait for the scans to come through.
I didn't see anything. No.
Takaki's missed a real bullet today. He's been hit at 60 kilometres an hour, and all he's sustained is a fracture to his arm. We're still left with a young man who's scared and alone in a country that he's not familiar with.
Is your mum or dad in Melbourne or no?
In Japan.
OK.
He'd ideally have his parents with him, but they're thousands of kilometres away.
Hello? Yes, the Japanese embassy. I'm a doctor calling from the Royal Melbourne Hospital, and I have a Japanese national who has been injured by a car. And I was just wondering whether you might be able to have a representative come over and visit him and support him.
There's no one at the embassy available to help Dr. Martin right now.
I'm going to ring you back a bit later on.
we need to provide a bit extra support to Kaki. That's what I would want for myself back when I was younger. It's certainly what I would want for my family.
I'm sorry to see you here. Can you tell me what happened?
In the emergency department, Japanese student Takaki has a badly broken left arm after being hit by a car.
I've been looking at your scans and I would recommend an operation to fix this with some plates and screws.
Orthopaedic registrar Dr. Patrick Elias has found a Japanese translator to tell Takaki he needs an operation.
With this type of injury and in someone of your age, I recommend you have the operation to help the bone heal in a better position. Would you like to proceed with the operation?
A long way from home and family, it's a big decision for the 21-year-old. Knowing Takaki will be having a stay in hospital, Dr. Martin continues his search for someone who can explain what's ahead and support him.
Hello, host mother. I'm looking after Takaki. Yes. And, well, he's scared is probably the first thing that I would say.
Dr. Martin finally tracks down the mother of the family Takaki's staying with.
Would you be in a position to come in and say hello to him and stuff?
Judy, Takaki's host mum. She understands the gravity of the situation and she's coming to the emergency department right now.
Takaki! Just relax, you're in good hospital here.
Yes. I was so scared of tomorrow.
No, you'll be all right. They'll put you to sleep.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, and you wake up and it'll all be over. Yeah. I hope so. Show your mum you're very brave.
Before Takaki's operation, his shoulder needs to be stabilised.
We're about to sit you up. So this will be a bit sore.
No.
Yeah, and then that will feel better after I sit you up and put a bandage on, all right? You're going to be really sore, I can see. Look at me. Look at me. Drop your shoulder down. Relax. 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 Better. Much better.
Looks miserable.
Dr. Martin has one last go communicating with Takaki before he's taken to the surgical wards, ready for his operation.
No.
Do you want more medication for the pain? Mm. No.
No, okay.
Yeah, he's not buying what we're selling here today. That's all right.
So the situation today for Takaki could have been far worse. He's been struck by a motor vehicle at over 60 kilometres an hour. For many people, they will not survive that sort of injury. He'll go back home and have an impressive story to tell his mates.
...23-year-old professional jockey Ethan was racing when his horse fell and rolled over him, causing life-threatening injuries.
Grossly positive, pass.
OK, so decision's op stat.
Trying to save his life, the team pumped blood into him before he was rushed to theatre for emergency surgery to try and fix a severed vein and ruptured liver. 7 weeks later, Ethan is making great strides in his recovery.
Murphy, come on.
I remember Celine being there. I was in a lot of pain and for her to be there really comforted me. The injuries I sustained and how close I probably did come to not making it has definitely changed my outlook on life. It's made me realise how precious life actually is. It's all right, Rosie.
The emergency doctors, all the staff, they just deserve the world. Like, what they did for Ethan, I can't thank him enough. He wants a cuddle from you.
I really want to ride again. It's just going to be a matter of time before I get fit and healthy.
1, 2, 3.
Very
don't
slow.
Move, don't move.
Sorry.
Back 2, 3.
There we go, okay.
French traveller Manon came into emergency with badly broken wrists after crashing her motorbike into a parked truck. To relieve her excruciating pain, Dr. Jason had to heavily sedate Manon so they could pull her wrists back into position.
You okay, Manon? You did very well.
Manon's husband, Joe, flew from Paris to be with her as soon as he got news of her crash.
Now I can move like this, so it's nice. I can move my fingers also. All the people in the emergency was cool, and I remember that. So they were super kind.
Surgeons fixed her wrists with metal plates, and after a final checkup, Manon was given the all clear.
Is everybody ready?
Yep.
One, two, three.
Slowly, slowly. Yes.
Japanese student Takaki was brought in with a badly broken arm after being hit by a car as he crossed a busy street.
You just got a broken bone.
Broken bone?
We can fix that.
The teen had to find a way around the language barrier to help a scared Takaki understand what was happening.
Can you see?
Yes, okay.
The next day, Takaki had a successful surgery to fix his broken arm and was able to go home with his host family to recuperate. 9 weeks pregnant Caitlin badly fractured her leg and wrist after a high-speed car accident. Doctors feared the 24-year-old may lose her baby.
So there's blood everywhere.
As Caitlin was taken to surgery to fix her broken bones, there was no guarantee her baby would survive. Caitlin had an operation to put a pin in her leg and set her broken arm.
It actually looks better than what it did before.
Now, 6 weeks later, she's back home being cared for by her mum and fiancé Riley, happily looking forward to the birth of their baby.
Thankfully, at my 13-week scan, baby was more than okay. Would not even tell we were in an accident, which was very great to hear. I think it could have been so much worse. I think we're both extremely lucky to be alive.